Welcome to day 182 of the 300 movie challenge. Today we watched the highest grossing film of July 2009, which was Harry Potter and the Half-Blood Prince.
Well, this was a bummer.
Yeah.
It was, because really, if you think about it, well, actually, no, that's not even true. Actually, a lot of these, the more recent Harry Potter movies have kind of ended in a bummer.
Yeah, because the previous one was Sirius dying, and then the previous one to that was Cedric dying.
Yeah.
So I feel like this held more of an impact than the previous two.
Yeah, it does.
Yeah, I kind of wanted to talk about, like, that, but I don't know if we should get into other things before that. Just, go right into the death part.
I don't know.
I guess that would be, well, I think at this point everyone knows about the death part, so you might as well just...
I mean, it's at this point become like a cultural running joke. So yeah, this is the movie where Dumbledore dies.
Mm-hmm.
And there were a lot of things about like that whole thing that I kind of like... I don't want to say like, but I'm going to say it. There were a lot of things that worked really well. And I think one of the
things... You mean how they executed it?
Yeah, like from start to finish. And I think one of the things that made it really, really impactful was the fact that when it happens, no one's speaking. Mm-hmm. You only hear the music. You see Dumbledore fall out of the tower. And then you see, like, Snape leaving. And then you see Harry. And then I think what it is that with that method, you also, like, you are also kind of in that kind of shock and denial stage where it's like, no, that didn't happen. Mm-hmm. Because you didn't hear anything besides the music, or sometimes it's just silence. So it takes you a minute to, like, have it sink in, and then right afterwards, we don't even, like, see Harry. We follow, like, Draco, who's just like, oh, shit, what have I gotten myself into? And then, like, the Death Eaters are leaving, and then only at the end of that scene does Harry come and, like, confront Snape.
Yeah.
And then they also have a very quiet moment, too. Like, Harry is kind of screaming at him, but he's just like... Because you can see that, okay, Snape and Dumbledore don't have to be your favorite characters for these scenes to mean something. Because it's like, people always are like, oh yeah, Snape is like a bad guy. But in this, even though he did the thing, you can tell that it's not what he wanted to do.
Yeah.
It's, yeah, I mean, the only problem I have with any of that, you know, plot aspect of it,
yeah,
is that they revealed that he made that deal, like, just straight up, flat out, oh yeah, he made this deal early on. So it's like, you know what I mean? It's, I feel like they just kind of revealed it too early, where it's like, oh yeah, he's obviously gonna do something bad.
Yeah.
You know?
That too, like, throughout the film, you see him interacting with Malfoy. And everything.
Yeah,
and
but
Malfoy
no,
himself is, like, not acting as he usually would. Because in all the previous films, he's always doing something.
Yeah, no, I know. But I mean, if they, yeah. I feel like if they just took that dead unbreakable vow thing out, but still had the interaction with Snape, then it would be like, you'd be like, wait, what the fuck is Snape doing? Right?
Yeah.
It would be more of a mystery. And I feel like that would make it... It still works really well, but I feel like that would be kind of the last kind of thing they could have maybe changed.
I don't really know why they didn't take it out and just put it as a flashback in, like, movie 7 or 8. That would have been better to, like, reveal the fact that, oh, it was something that he promised Narcissa, like, the previous movie, not in the beginning of said movie where the big thing happens.
Yeah.
And...
Because once you see that scene, then you know that Draco that there's something happening with Draco and stuff because he got chosen and stuff.
Right.
So yeah. You don't find it suspicious, the fact that he's, like, purposely not confronting, like, Harry and his friends and stuff.
Yeah, because the thing is
and
that...
And then, yeah. Go on.
Yeah, what Malin mentioned during, like, when we were watching is, like, oh, yeah, these kids, like, they grew up to act really well.
Mm-hmm.
And they know their roles really well. So then if, like, just forgetting the first scene with, like, Snape and Narcissa, then you do see that they're acting kind of weird, and it's like,
yeah,
Draco's not like this. He's not, like, you know, timid, and he doesn't, like, lurk in the shadows. He's very, like, in your face. He's like, yeah, I'm gonna, like, fuck shit up. And then Snape is also kind of like, you disgust me most of the time. But in this movie, you barely see them. Whenever you do see them, they're together, and it does seem like something is going on. So you absolutely don't need that first scene. If you wanted to, like, bring Narcissa into it, that's what movie 7 and 8 are for, because, you know, she does have a role in those movies, too. And she doesn't really have one in this one besides, like, the opening scene to, like, set up this whole plot, but you don't need to set it up. You just need it to happen, and
yeah,
no matter,
like,
how it happens, it's gonna work.
Because I was trying to imagine, like, you know, what if I really didn't know, right, what was gonna happen? I'm like, well, that beginning thing, I still feel like that would have kind of given it away.
Yeah.
That was gonna happen. So... Yeah. And again, it sucks because, like, it is a good scene. It's just like, ah! You were like, you were so close to being, like, really, really, really good. And you're still really good, but it's just like, eh! You know, so...
But, that said, the impact of, like, the mind-blowingness they showcased really well with, like, Beatrice, like, destroying everything.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And that was also, like, it was just her laughing, but otherwise... nothing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I thought, like, the morning scene was also really good with, like, you see Dumbledore and you see, like, a very, like, shadowy shot of him.
Mm.
And I don't know, he looks peaceful, but you know it's not supposed to be like that because of how the lighting is and how the atmosphere is, and you're just like, this person isn't supposed to be dead.
Yeah, it's actually the visual style of this film is, like, it's really good.
It's
just something I noticed where, like, this the shot, like, the angles and the lighting and all that kind of stuff, it conveys, like, the emotion really, really well.
Yeah.
Much better than before, definitely.
Yeah. And, like, what was I gonna say? Oh, what am I trying to think of? The colors actually of that, like, ending scene with, like, it's kind of dark, yet there's still this, like, kind of morning glow in the back.
Yeah.
Reminds me very heavily of that scene in Star Wars The Clone Wars. That is, like, my favorite scene of anything ever. So it reminded me of that, and it was, again, kind of that, like, bittersweet atmosphere.
Mm.
Like, after talking about that, I'm just like, I feel like we shouldn't talk about anything else. Because it's, like, it's such, like, it's the biggest part of, like, you know... the movie. It feels weird to backtrack after this, but I think we probably should.
Yeah, we have to, unfortunately. But I guess moving gone from Draco, Snape, and Dumbledore and everything, the main trio have quite a weird transition phase where in the previous movies, we've kind of seen them go through the awkward lovey-dovey stages.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
With, like, love drama and everything, and then now, suddenly, Ron confesses, well, confesses, quote-unquote, to Hermione.
It's super vague.
Yeah, and Harry gets with Ginny? I guess, Valen, did you have any, like, inkling that that would happen?
Just, like, if I was to just say, based off of this movie by itself, I would have thought that Harry and Hermione would have gotten together.
Yeah.
I kind of like that they didn't. Because it's, again, it's kind of the whole, like, you know, oh, the main guy obviously gets the main girl. You know what I mean? It's kind of not that. So that's something. And actually, what I do... The thing with Ginny, I'm not totally sure how I feel about that. But with Ron and Hermione, I kind of like it. And also the sense of, like... It is awkward. So... And, like, that kind of stuff, it is awkward, like, to really start that. You know what I mean? Because, right. Like, they don't know how to feel. They don't know the other person's going to feel. So it felt kind of... It was awkward, but it was naturally awkward.
Mm.
There was actually a couple moments with the characters that were, like, kind of this. It was awkward, right? With some of the dialogue.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
Still felt natural.
I think we can all agree that the most hilarious scene was when Harry drank the liquid lotion.
Oh my god, yeah. Oh man, I think people usually say that like Harry is usually a little bit more witty and sarcastic in the books, and I think seeing him with the liquid luck, I could definitely see that now.
Yeah.
Like, more of book Harry came out in that, or from what I understand, just based off of what I've heard about how he actually acts, and I will say that I do like this version of Harry quite a lot. It's just, like, smiling so weirdly and stuff.
Poor Hagrid, too.
Oh, yeah. Funny story about that. I was about to, like get up and, like, get a snack really quick, and then I looked over and I saw that, oh, what was the spider's name?
I forget.
Hagrid's spider died. And I was like, what the fuck happened? So when I came back, that whole scene played out with, like, the liquid luck and Harry being kind of hilarious and just the spider funeral. Oh my god, yeah. That was definitely worth an extra 20 minutes before I could eat. That was pretty funny. I think there was another scene that was kind of funny, but I don't remember where it was.
Oh, was it Luna?
Oh, yeah, yeah, Luna! With the lion head!
What? I don't understand. I don't think we're supposed to understand.
Luna is Luna, you don't have to understand her. That's all you need to know.
I wish we saw more of her, actually.
I always wish we had more of Luna.
Yeah, I kind of thought that, like, when she was introduced, that, like, we were going to see more of her in the next thing. In this movie, she kind of isn't here, so... Eh.
Except in the very beginning where she, like, unpetrified Harry and then lion head. But otherwise, you don't see her at all afterward.
I think he took her as a date to the Christmas party, too. But we didn't get to see her.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
She had the most hilarious dress, too.
Actually, something interesting that I remember reading was that Daniel Radcliffe actually said that he didn't like how he portrayed Harry in this movie.
Oh, really?
Oh.
And I read that, like, a bit ago, so I was, like, coming into this with that in mind. And, yeah, I don't really see it. Like, he is kind of a bit kind of moody and awkward, but, like, it feels
It felt right.
Yeah, it makes sense here, so I don't really understand that.
Maybe he felt like he was too awkward? I don't know. I mean, it's an awkward age, so I would say that he did really well.
Yeah.
And I guess the important thing is that when there needed to be, like, certain intense emotions, he did deliver them. So I think that's the most important thing. Like, he completely sold the last, like, what, 15 minutes?
Yeah.
He completely sold that. I don't understand why he didn't like his portrayal. I would say maybe his portrayal of himself in, I don't know, like, Goblet of Fire was a little bit more awkward. I don't know. I thought he was good here.
I think in general, from what I heard, he didn't usually like his, like, watching his own movies that he acted in and stuff.
Okay, that I can see, because it's kind of like the perfectionism, I wish I did this better kind of thing, and that's understandable.
Yeah. We're all just thinking of that last 15 minutes.
Yeah, I'm like internally crying. If they cut out the beginning scene with Narcissa and Snape, I probably would have like bawled my eyes out. Because I hate it when the mentor old man character gets killed off. Because I get really sad.
It usually always happens, though.
I know, and it sucks because they're, like, usually one of my favorite characters.
It's... Actually, because, like, I'm thinking of probably, like, who are the most, like, famous, well-known kind of old man mentors. And I'm thinking, you know, like, Dumbledore, Gandalf, and Obi-Wan. Right? And I'm like, of those... Gandalf lives, and then Obi-Wan, I mean, he does die in A New Hope, but, like, he still comes back as, like, the Force Ghost, right? So it's like, I mean, maybe I'm wrong, but it seems like Dumbledore's the only one who's like, oh yeah, he's dead, he's totally gone. You know what I mean? So it's like, huh, interesting. But,
With Gandalf, you think... It's like, gotcha.
I was happy that he was still alive. I was like, okay, good. You're still here. Cool.
Yeah.
Love.
But, actually, I guess, here's a question for you.
Mm-hmm.
Compared to the other five movies, how would you compare this one?
I think... The first one is still the most, but in terms of, like, the more modern movies, I guess this would be second.
I'm honestly, I might say I like this one the most. I don't know, it's weird, because, like, there is some awkward stuff in here. Like, again, that scene we talked about, but then also, like, there's some moments where it's like, this is awkward, and it's supposed to be awkward, right? And there's others where it's like, you're not totally sure. And there's a few plot lines that kind of seem to don't really matter, like, near the beginning. Like, the whole thing about, like, that other guy, like, trying to hit on Hermione kind of, like, doesn't matter.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So there's a few of that, but again, I think, like, the emotion that carries through it, especially at that end, is, like, I think that kind of pushes it above the others for me. But it's very close either way. So I kind of see this first one and Order of the Phoenix is like very, very close to each other. So
I think I have to put the first one on top, but I think I like this one more than Order of the Phoenix.
Yeah, I have to think about it still.
I have to say. Because I feel like I liked more scenes from this movie.
That's true.
And in Order of the Phoenix, because Order of the Phoenix, well, the villain was very, like, you wanted to, like, strangle her and everything and stuff, and it carried that very well and stuff. Here, it's more of, like, it plays, like, the moods very well and stuff, and while it doesn't make you angry, it invokes a harder emotion, which is, like, just plain grief. Basically.
Yeah, it's very somber kind of throughout the film.
Yeah.
And actually, yeah. Oh, one thing that I noticed, because there's the kind of, there's some Quidditch stuff in the earlier part, right?
Mm.
But in my head, I was like comparing these Quidditch scenes to the first ones in the first movie.
Oh yeah, these were so good.
Yeah.
And
these were much better.
Well, not only that, but it was so much like darker and grayer.
Oh yeah.
Right.
It took place in winter too.
No, I know, but that's what I'm saying. Like, just visually.
No, yeah, that's what I'm agreeing with you. That yeah. It took place in winter, because usually when they show the first Quidditch match, it's usually like summertime and everything, or like it's at least green
yeah.
and stuff. So
it's just again, it's that like, whole interesting. It's again, it's that slow progression of the color palettes throughout the series. And, you know, it's kind of going back to the first one now. It's like, for example, if we, like, went back to watch, like, Sorcerer's Stone, like, right now, we'd probably be like, what the fuck is that? Like, this is weird, right? Why is everyone so happy? So, yeah, it's interesting.
I think, after talking about it, I think this would probably be, like, the best out of the modern ones, at least at the moment. I don't know about how I would feel about the 7th and 8th ones at the moment.
Yeah, I have no idea.
But I think another thing that might also make this one a little bit stronger than Order of the Phoenix is Sirius Black, we know for two movies.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we don't know him for that
long. Dumbledore,
I wish we knew him for longer.
Yeah, I wish we did too. But Dumbledore, we've had him for six movies. And again, I know there are people who don't like Dumbledore. I can understand that. Even if you don't like him, he's still a presence, and having him gone, it's like that whole thing of, like, sometimes, like, there are certain people who, if they're gone or if they die, then it means something. Even if you didn't like them, they left an impact.
Well, for me, like, in the first, like, four movies, I didn't dislike him, I just thought he was just not super interesting.
He was just, yeah.
But then, like, Order of the Phoenix, I'm like, oh, he's getting interesting. And then here, it was kind of, you know, even though I knew where it was going, I'm like, he actually has a character. He is more interesting now. So now it's like, oh, he's actually getting interesting, and now he's gone. So I could maybe see an argument for that's a bad thing, but I could also see it as more like, you know, all right, you're really getting invested in him, and then your soul is crushed. You know
okay,
what I mean?
Yeah.
So,
that's a storytelling thing. Mm-hmm. Usually people should, I don't like to use this word, but should, they should kill off a character if they're in the height of their character arc, because it leaves the most impact
yeah,
on
definitely.
The audience.
Yeah.
Another good example is Full Metal Alchemist. Everyone knows which one.
Don't spoil it.
I'm just leaving it at that.
I'm a bad person who has only seen the first four episodes and still hasn't seen the rest.
You should go watch the
I'm
rest
sorry.
Of the and then we can talk about more things, like the fact that me and my head were talking about this during the movie, how Tom Riddle looked like Pride, actually.
Oh yeah, and when you pointed that out, I was like, oh my god, yeah, he does. Like, even, like, the clothes.
Even the clothes and, like, the hairstyle and, like, the look on his face, I was like, oh my god, that's Pride.
Creepy child vibes. I was like, yeah, you're right. He is totally just Pride.
I have no idea what we're talking about. But that
I hate that kid so much.
But, Yeah, is there anything else to say about this? I mean, I think you can gather that it's very good, very, you know, emotionally powerful, definitely.
It's top two?
Yeah, definitely, it's at least
top
two.
I mean,
they
didn't even include a funny scene with Harry's awful, like, adopted family.
Oh yeah, they weren't in this movie at all.
Oh yeah.
Yeah,
oh, that
itself should show the mood of this film.
Yeah, I read on Wikipedia that, like, that was in the book, but they specifically took it out because they're like, it doesn't fit with the tone of what we're going for.
That was a good decision to make.
Yeah, and also apparently there was, like, a longer, like, funeral for Dumbledore kind of thing, and they cut that out too because they're like, you know, Again, the emotion of the death itself is the important part, right?
Yeah, if you drag it out too long, then it gets a little bit lost.
Yeah.
You want to leave the audience sad at the end. Yeah.
So, there you go. That's that. What is next? I don't even remember.
I don't know.
Next is...
It doesn't matter.
Ha! Oh boy!
We're
in for a rude awakening.
You guys haven't seen this film, right?
No.
No.
It's surprisingly, a film that I've seen of all things.
I know who made it and roughly what it's about. So
I know who made it.
I honestly have no idea what to expect.
That'll be for another day.
Okay.
AKA tomorrow.
Yeah. So.
On that note.
Bye.
On a very somber note. Goodbye.